Blackstone Audio presents Peggy Guggenheim, The Shock of the Modern, by Francine Prose. This book is read by Carrington MacDuffie. In writing about Peggy, it's important to listen to one's own instinct. Don't listen to critics. What do they know? What one should say about Peggy is simply that she did it, that no matter what her motivations were, she did it. Lee Krasner. I am not an art collector. I am a museum. Peggy Guggenheim. The Angel of the City. I begin to see Peggy Guggenheim as the last of Henry James's transatlantic heroines, Daisy Miller with rather more balls. Gore Vidal. The Peggy Guggenheim collection is visible from the water, from the private boats, and from the Vaporetto, the public ferry that crisscrosses the Grand Canal on its serpentine course through Venice. The museum is located in the Palazzo Venier de Leoni, a palace that was begun in the 18th century and left unfinished, its construction interrupted some decades before the Napoleonic Wars. The white building, with its stone facade, is arresting, partly because it has only one story and is so unlike the tall, elaborate Gothic, Renaissance, and Baroque palazzi that line the canal, and partly because something about its spare, slightly severe elegance makes it a bit difficult to place in time. Is it 18th century, neoclassical, or modern, an ancient Roman temple with a hint of the 1950s ranch house? For 30 years, it was where Peggy Guggenheim lived and where she installed one of the world's greatest collections of modern art. And it is where that art has remained since her death in 1979. Among the artists represented in the collection that she began to assemble long before the significance and value of their work was widely or fully recognized are Picasso, Pollock, Brancusi, Arp, Brock, Calder, de Kooning, Rothko, Duchamp, Ernst, Giacometti, Kandinsky, Klee, Leger, Magritte, Miro, Mondrian, Man Ray, Henry Moore, and Francis Bacon. It was Peggy's decision to place Marino Marini's 1948 bronze, The Angel of the City, L'Agnello della Città, at the entrance to her home, front and center on the landing facing the Grand Canal, and nearly impossible not to notice if one is passing by boat. The bronze statue depicts a heavily simplified and abstracted horse and rider, reminiscent of Etruscan sculpture. The horse's neck and head are more or less parallel to the ground. The rider's body rises from the horse at a right angle. His arms are outstretched and flung open wide, his head tipped back, as if in ecstasy. His body is arched, his phallus erect. The statue's most striking visual elements are horse, rider, penis. Specifically, a penis pointed at the traffic, the boats and passengers traveling between the museum and on the other side of the Grand Canal, the massive Palazzo Corner, which serves as the headquarters of the prefect of Venice. In her memoir, Peggy claims that Marini fashioned the statue so that the phallus was removable and that she detached it when she knew that nuns might be passing by. There were many works of sculpture that Peggy could have chosen for the landing, and it says something about her nature, her ironic, playful, lifelong desire to shock, that she selected this particular piece of modern art with which to amuse or confront the officials and citizens of Venice. Peggy's mentor and advisor, the art critic and historian Sir Herbert Reed, described the statue's placement as a challenge to the prefect. Peggy claimed that the best view of it was in profile, from her living room, where she liked to sit and observe visitors reacting to Marini's work. What also makes the gesture so characteristic of Peggy are the contradictions and the ambivalence it expresses, the particular mixture of affection and provocation. Venice was, after all, a city that she deeply loved. Out of This Century. In 1946, Peggy Guggenheim published Out of This Century, a wry and revealing account of her life so far. She was 48 years old. In New York, her avant-garde museum gallery, Art of This Century, was a critical and popular success. Opened in October 1942, the innovatively designed exhibition space on West 57th Street had become a gathering place for the most important artists then working in New York, a showcase for exiled European émigrés and talented young American painters. One of Peggy's assistants, Marius Bewley, noted who came to the gallery, how often, and for how long. Breton, around a great deal, Tanguy, often, Fernand Léger, Ossip Zadkina, and Marc Chagall, Mata, Pavel Chelychev, was there a lot, Duchamp, frequently, Man Ray, once or twice, Barr, frequently, Kiesler, Alexander Calder, all the time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.